we must dance, 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 dance in God's honor. We must yield all our steps unto the King. We must dance, 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 dance in God's honor. Let His praises ring throughout the earth.
And welcome to the Oddity Archive, the show that I'm considering renaming Geek Porn for some reason. Anyway, a few episodes back, we did a show on backwards subliminal messaging in music. Today, we're going to take a deeper look at the quote-unquote documentary that prodded me into doing that episode to begin with. Namely, the 1989 evangelical epic Hell's Bells, The Dangers of Rock and Roll, which I recently found a copy of at a local thrift store. Then, after that, we're going to take a look at a couple of conspiracy theories that are discussed in this film. Like...
So a soft egg placed in front of a speaker at some of the louder rock concerts... Can midway through the concert become a hard-boiled snack?
Now, before we start, let me just say that I have no problem with religion in general, or certainly any kind of moral compass. In fact, I tend to be quite in favor of such things. But what I do have a problem with is folks that take the holy, or even the innocuous, and twist the facts, perhaps even lie outright, for their own personal gain, which I personally believe that this film does. You don't have to agree with me. So, let's take a look. There are tons of clips from tons of music videos, albums, and Hollywood movies on here. The sheer tonnage of licensing costs to make something like this would sink most multi-million dollar projects. With that, I'm 99.99999% certain that the clips used in here were never licensed, making this home video classic a bit dubious, legally speaking. I mean, there's not even any kind of acknowledgement of the existence of any of the clips during the credits. In context, it makes the opening legal notices absolutely hilarious. In the name of fairness, Reel to Reel Ministries, the company that made this, is apparently a registered nonprofit organization. Having said that, I'm not sure if selling your tapes at $40 a pop, in $1989 dollars no less, is exactly ethical. Indeed, if you visit Reel to Reel's website, now primarily known as the Apologetics Group, it's more like visiting a major online retailer. Did I mention that Hell's Bells has been reissued on DVD? This thing is hosted by one Eric Holmberg. I have not been able to find any sort of biography or backstory on this guy. The only thing I've got to go on is towards the end of Hell's Bells, Holmberg implies that he's a former rock musician, or at least some sort of ex-hedonist, who became born again in the early 80s.
And you'll have the power to change, to be a true child of God. I did this 9 years ago, at the height of my own rock and roll days, and my life was eternally changed. I know it may be kind of scary, but God will do the same for you.
I wonder what's on the tube.
All right. We start with a semi-amusing sketch that begins with, presumably Holmberg, doing a little off-camera channel surfing, culminating in a commercial for a mock KTEL sort of compilation. If I'm not mistaken, Holmberg is attempting to act in this particular clip as well. He's the one on the left.
Man, whatever happened to real music?
Man, I'm talking the good old days. Yeah. AC/DC, Highway to Hell. Highway to Hell.
Missing those great heavy metal songs that set the world's feet a-stomping? Cool Out Concession Records has just put together 30 of the top metal hits of the me generation into one double record set. Notes from the Underground.
And that was about as entertaining as this thing gets, folks. It's also home to the only humor in the entire film. I just can't call this a documentary. It's a film to me. Anyway, from there we finally get to see Holmberg unfettered and in full 1989 regalia. You know, now that I think about it, I think I've seen this guy somewhere before, but I'm just not sure where.
For the discriminating adult.
Nah, couldn't be. Hell's Bells is broken down into five rather lengthy segments. I don't intend on going into all of them as part of this review segment, but everything pertinent will be touched upon in some way, shape, or form at some point in this episode.
Ew! To preempt the inevitable outcries of censorship, let me go on record. We're not here pushing for record banning, record burning, or even the dubious practice of writing rock albums.
The film proper starts with a speech about how there is no intention to encourage censorship or to steer anyone towards or away from any particular form of music. Then he spends the rest of the film pretty much lambasting you for listening to anything but quote-unquote pure music, which he doesn't even get around to describing and giving examples of until the end of the damn film, 3 friggin' hours later.
Gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature, following its desires and its thoughts, being by nature children of wrath. Or we can turn our ears to heaven's music and allow God to teach us a new dance, a new way of living our lives.
All creation moves in a cosmic dance before the Lord her King. And the rhythm's the reason, the rhyme of the dance. Pulses within everything, and the universe.
As they left their convent to attend worship services, they were shocked to behold across the street a grotesque life-size effigy of Jesus on the cross, which John had fashioned and hung from his balcony. As the sisters gazed in astonishment at this sacrilegious display, John started pelting them with Durex condoms filled with water.
This film is loaded with false claims and all-around poor research. At one point, Holmberg cites Albert Goldman's 1988 biography of John Lennon, The Lives of John Lennon. Holmberg mindlessly regurgitates one of the book's most infamous claims, namely that while in Hamburg, Germany, during the Beatles' early days, Lennon spent Ash Wednesday one year dropping water-filled condoms on nuns from a nearby balcony, then urinating on them, and burning an effigy of Jesus Christ. The same book that Holmberg got this little tidbit from also claims that John had a homosexual affair with manager Brian Epstein, that John somehow arranged for Paul McCartney to be arrested on drug charges in Japan, that John killed a man in Hamburg, and that he took a trip to the Caribbean at some point to participate in some sort of voodoo ceremony. All claims that have never been mentioned anywhere else and remain unsubstantiated to this day.
Christianity will go. It will vanish and shrink. We're more popular than Jesus. Unquote.
Later in the film, Holmberg cites an article for Rolling Stone magazine written by Robert Palmer, the journalist, not the singer. But Holmberg can't be bothered with that fact.
As rock artist and writer Robert Palmer described in his article on them for Rolling Stone magazine, when the music and energy were at their height, the tribesmen milled in ecstatic trances.
Ooh, I got another one. You know Ozzy Osbourne's song Mr. Crowley? The one where he criticizes occultist Aleister Crowley and his beliefs? Here's what Holmberg has to say about it.
A year later, the self-professed shaman or witch doctor of rock and roll was dead. Ozzy Osbourne sings a song entitled Mr. Crowley. Celtic Frost.
Well, it must be evil then. I think I've made my point. This is how Holmberg operates throughout this whole thing. Screw the research, just give me some more ammo. Over the course of 3 hours and 5 minutes, Holmberg spends about 3/4 of that time simply browbeating the viewer with out-of-context quotes and scriptures over song clip after song clip. When he does this, I like to refer to these sequences as his lobotomized hissy fits.
As Jesus himself said, that which natural man does is of no real use. Jesus himself said that there are two paths. One is a road traveled by the multitude. Contrary to Sammy Hagar's advice, Jesus said that if we are to have heaven, on earth or anywhere else, we must be born again.
Call me Captain Obvious.
Hi, Captain Obvious.
Not bad. I get the feeling that the idea was to ram as much quote-unquote info down the viewer's throat as rapidly as possible, attempting to stifle any kind of thought on the viewer's part. Like a politician, Holmberg talks a lot without actually saying
anything.
True to
the satanic form, Jesus is ignored or made fun of. The Christian standard of morality has been gutted. The method, however, is to examine its fruit, the actions and attitudes it ultimately generates, and find a good church where people are sincerely living for God.
As I've repeatedly implied, this film is very difficult to sit through. I mean, it's dull, and it's repetitive, and probably on purpose. I mean, this is like a slow-witted abortion of a film. This is like a bad Wikipedia article of a film. In fact, if this film were a Wikipedia article, it would probably be flagged every way to Sunday. Fast forward to 2003, and Holmberg has made a sequel to Hell's Bells, imaginatively titled Hell's Bells 2. Holmberg hasn't changed much since 89. In fact, I could swear that the man sleeps encased in amber. Anyway, I thought Hell's Bells 1 was overkill at 3 hours and change. Well, that's nothing. The damn sequel runs for 6.5 hours. I admit, I've only seen part of this. Hell's Bells 1 was such a bloodletting of a film that I haven't yet developed the strength to tackle the sequel head-on, but judging by the first 15 minutes, it looks like more of the same, only at half speed.
How do we judge righteously? How do we ultimately discern what's right?
We'll be right back.
If you or your church is interested in a live presentation of Hell's Bells, we can come to your church or community and over 2 evenings hold a dynamic outreach. One of our ministers will provide live narration with a specially edited 16mm film combined with slides. They will also be available for personal ministry and answering questions. In the past, we have seen great outpourings of God's Spirit as thousands of young people and adults have made commitments to Christ. Over 300 churches nationwide have opened their doors to this ministry. Here is what a few of the pastors have said. This seminar was the most informative and moving experience that our church has had relating to the dangers involved for our young people in the world of music. At the end of the 2-day seminar, the altars were filled with adults and young people seeking the Lord. Informative, enlightening, and challenging. Your seminar brought a cleansing to our lives. Approximately 200 people flooded the altar that night. It proved to be one of the most informative events that our youth and adults have ever experienced together. When the invitation was given, over 50 responded. If you would like information on how you can bring Hell's Bells live to your location, please write or call us.
Now I admit, the main reason I wanted to do this episode was so that I could test out a couple of Holmberg's conspiracy theories. So, first up, we're going to partially revisit the backwards masking concept from a few episodes ago. And, in fact, this is going to be the Archive's first ever audience participation segment.
Yay!
So here's the idea. I'm going to play one of Holmberg's clips forwards, just so you know what it is. then I'm going to play it again backwards against a black background. No text, no nothing. And what I want you to do is note, mentally or otherwise, what you hear, if anything. And then I'm going to play the clip again through Holmberg's eyes. Then you can compare notes. So, enough of my yakking. Let's do this. Here's example number one. Okay, did you hear anything? I personally didn't. Let's try another one. Here's example number two. Okay, this is getting us nowhere. Why don't we play one of Holmberg's speeches backwards and see if we get anything? I'm a little teapot, short and stout. Here's my handle, and here's my spout. When I get all steamed up, hear me shout. Tip me over and pour me out. That was awesome! But I thought only Satanists could think backwards. I think I may have just experienced a slight epiphany. Anyway, I said we would discuss two conspiracy theories. And so, just watch this clip. I think you'll get the gist of it.
For example, research has found that shrill sounds of sufficient volume can congeal proteins in a liquid media. So a soft egg placed in front of a speaker at some of the louder rock concerts can midway through the concert become a hard-boiled snack for the weary headbanger. Does anybody have any salt here?
Okay, unsurprisingly, none of the local rock clubs around here would let me try this. So, let's try a homebrew version. Here we have probably the loudest, most senselessly overcompressed disc that I own. So, let's try her out. Fire up the CD player, and we're gonna crank it. All right, so we are in the CD player. We're going in, we're pausing. We're gonna play this album the whole way through, although you're not gonna have to sit through it, only I am. We've got an egg. We've got a rather shaky stack here, but we've gotta try this. Okay, there's our egg, and there's the speakers. Will this work? Let's find out. And play.
Don't think
Okay. Oh, dying here. All right. Let's try this. So, can vibration hard boil an egg? God, I hope so. Dang.
And that brings us to the end of another episode of the Oddity Archive. Join us next time when we're joined by the local police, who will give me numerous noise pollution citations for that last experiment. See you next time.
Therefore, make peace with your God, whatever you conceive him to be, hairy thunderer or cosmic muffin. With all its hopes, dreams, promises, and urban renewal, the world continues to deteriorate. Give up.
You are a
Smart. 7 minutes ago.